now we know each other very well. So yeah, we're sitting here at Jagmag Thela. We're talking about our event that's coming up on 9th and 10th, the Handmade Collective. We have Swati from Gohar, Jaya from Indiji, Divya, who's a journalist and an avid traveler, Jiten from Jagmag, the host, Pradeep Pillai from Pradeep Pillai, and Ruchi from Indiji. So yeah, we wanted to talk more about what you guys do. So to begin with, how and why did you guys start your businesses or what you are doing right now? We could start with you, Jaya. How did you guys start Indiji and why did you decide to do it?
Well, both Ruchi and I went to classmates, and we ever since had a real interest in, like, great interest in handmade and handcrafted and stuff like that. We were not really interested in industrial design or factory made. So I think that was the real pull at that point. But of course, we worked and then we kept getting back to the idea as to wanting to start something of our own. And then we started in June 2011. And, yeah, so then I think it was the love for handmade.
How about you, Jiten? This place has become quite a landmark. A lot of people come here to check out the place. Could you tell us more about Jagmag Thela and Jagmag Art and Culture Project?
Okay. So Jagmag Thela is a street culture inspired chai coffee place. The idea is to do a lot of things in the way that they happen in the street, but of course adapting it for the modern urban context. Jagmag Art and Culture Project is also effectively, I think, an extension of the art and culture that we typically experience on the streets, whether it's the bazaars or the street performers or people who do things. You know, like in India, we didn't really have auditoriums per se, except in the mahals. You know, the common folk did something under a tree at the chaupal or something like that happened. And the art and project culture is kind of like a platform to take that sort of a spirit forward and to share it with people who come to the cafe or who want to just come and experience those things.
Pradeep, how about you? Where did you start? What are the biggest challenges when you started?
I passed out from life. I did my fashion design. I was never get the fact that, you know, fashion keeps changing every 6 months or a year. So, sarees, I think it's more of a classic garment. My style is contemporary classes, so it's, the design is modern, but still you can keep on wearing it for forever. You can pass it on.
Generation.
More like a hair look.
Do you face any challenges?
So the biggest challenge in weaving is that nowadays everybody wants, comes and asks, "Hey, aaj naya kya hai?" So no, I always tell them that naya kya purana jo hai, wohi sabse sahi. So you know, it's like, you know, the skill sets are going down day by day. So you know, I think something that was made with the older skill set, I think that's much more luxury than something that's very, nowadays everybody wants to make a big buck. So same with weavers, they don't want to do really high skill crafts.
Almost sounds like you should not be selling your sarees and keeping them for a later date. So that they're more valuable 10 years from now than they are today.
Swati, you take care of the business side of Gohar. If you could tell us some of the challenges you face and what do you do, what is Gohar about? You could introduce us to that as well.
So Gohar is basically into handmade concrete products. So when we started, we were the first people to launch concrete products in India. There were a lot of companies or the designers who were doing such things, you know, abroad. But that was a new concept in India. Initially when we had started, definitely, you know, people were not really open about, you know, how it's a material which is a building material as a part of the interiors, how is it going to work. So we had faced a lot of challenges, even today we face a lot, but still the people have started accepting more. And they're more open, you know, they can take it, to experiment with it. But it's a very beautiful material to see. It's raw, but it can enhance the entire interiors.
called Handmade Collective. Just the idea of what does handmade mean to each one of you. Maybe you can start with Divya. Divya who travels a lot and loves to explore indigenous products. So you have an inkling towards handmade products. If you could just share why you prefer handmade over other things.
You know, it took me a few years to fall in love with handmade things. When I was working as a journalist, I realized the cost of fast fashion because I was doing a lot of stories in Bangladesh and sweatshops around Delhi and how they were deploying businesses. So you don't want to wear a shirt or a printed shirt which a lot of fashion brands say sustainable fashion. It's not sustainable fashion. You don't know who's making your clothes and they never disclose that. So that was the biggest turn off for me for fast fashion. Then I want to invest in pieces which stays with me forever. I can reuse, restyle, and just like, you know, just wear them and they make me feel powerful. The main aim of clothes is to, you know, make you feel powerful, take your personality out. That's why I love handmade.
So there is an argument where people who believe in handmade products, they say the product is much better than, as Divya said, that it lasts longer. You guys make these products, maybe you could help us understand how it's better quality or long-lasting product than a machine-made product, especially when it comes to clothing, perhaps.
I think for us, the idea of handmade is A, that there's a lot of labor that goes into making of that one garment because we work on the fabric which is kind of made by hand. It's either a khadi or a khadi cotton or a khadi silk. Then there's hand printing, natural dyeing that goes into the physical fabric or hand embroidery that's done by women, very, very detailed and very time consuming. So, A, because it's all natural fibers and fabrics, it is something that's going to last you for a longer time. The product itself is treated very well in terms of finishing and detailing, so it's not something that will kind of start to tear apart or the seams will kind of start ripping apart. There's immense importance given to the quality of the final product that's coming out. So definitely it is something that will take you a long time. And because it has passed through so many hands and there are just so many elements in it which make it so organic, it's absolutely, it's a lovely feeling to have it on your skin. So it's more than just wearing a piece of garment, it's about carrying stories from different geographies.
So I think that's one thing common with everybody who's making stuff handmade over here, that they work with a lot of people, they provide a lot of employment to crafts people. If you guys could shed some light on what it is to work with different kinds of people, especially artisans. Recently did some documentary where you traveled to a location nearby and met with craftspeople. If you could share their lifestyle, what you saw, how they're living and they're earning their wages.
You know, so I have been working as a journalist for French people for the last 10 years. It's long, you know, but so I have been meeting on and off artisans in different villages from Bengal and Orissa, and then you understand how much effort goes in making what they make. And the other problem was, like he said, migration, the rivers, they all come to cities and they're living in slum and leaving what they have back home because no one values it. So like people like indigenous, they give them jobs, there's a reverse migration which is very, very important. And then when I went to Bareilly to work for this brand Unleashed, and it was very interesting for me to meet women because there are a lot of women who do this job as well, and for them it's a new source of empowerment because they can work while their kids are around and they don't have to leave their house, And it was really moving to meet some of them because for us it's just a t-shirt or a dress. Because for them it means a lot more. Like they can pay their kids' school fees or they can get medicine or just basically, like, you know, if you're part of a stigma society, not go out and still work from home and make an earning. Because if you, the ratio, if what men earn and what women mostly use it at home, and men are only using 40% of that money at home and just wasting that money. So for me, that was really important. So there's a lot of factors which make handmade very interesting. It's not about wearing. It's about, like I said, a piece of clothing will make you feel powerful. Powerful because of the awareness that who has made my clothes and how it has helped, where the money has filtered down.
See, I could add to it. Like, you know, one of the leaders, he was making this tree of life. So he told me, I asked him, how long have you been painting this? He said, I have 15 betiyon ki shaadi is design se karwaya. So, you know, that's what I think is real luxury. That, you know, design should be classic. So, it shouldn't.
It provides for a lot of opportunities for people who wouldn't see that, like, means for that kind of wages.
Mm.
Quantity of clothes, like Jaya was saying, it's very important because all the fast fashion works in season. They will never make a good quality clothes because otherwise why would you buy the second season? So they have to make something which is going to fall apart. That's why handmade fashion or handmade artisanal clothes are more interesting because you can just reuse them. So in today's day we don't need more consumption, which is be sensible consumption.
And I think everybody's talking about fair trade and, you know, fair trade in a certain parameter, so workspace, wages of course, hours of work. So like Vidya said, working with women especially, women folk, and if they can be working from their home fronts, that's perfect because for them, they can decide the number of hours they spend, they get their wages, and also their space is their space. So, you know, when you don't go to a factory or a shed to go and spend 8 hours of work, you can be working only probably 5 and 6, depending on how much time you have. And I also feel that this also is a dissemination of knowledge, because, you know, the woman teaches embroidery to her daughter, to her daughter-in-law, it goes, it passes on, so it's also kind of a way that you can see the craft skill.
I mean, today whenever we come here, it seems like a really close-knit family with people who work here. If you could share how it is to, who are the people who work here, how do you make it more hospitable for them, and how is the product better with the people that you're working with?
Sure. So, you know, like, but this also connects to your original question about how high end quality is better. And I think quality generally is not about how long that garment is going to last you, outside of the fast fashion context, of course. But in terms of how much effort and value addition to the maker's life has gone into it, right? And so it's handmade stops reverse migration, creates reverse migration, it finds people's livelihoods. But I find what most interesting is that it generates much higher employment per item than a factory thing does, because a factory production, actually, you know that two guys can be operating a machine that's producing the same that about 100 hand weavers would be doing. And I think for us it's similar here, in the sense that you can have advanced machines filtering through your chai patti to pick out the stuff, but there is just something different about, also in terms of employment, in terms of the feeling and the effort that goes in. Mean, if like five people sit down under the sun, under the tree, and kind of filter out the things and they do it like that. So it's a fairly handmade process in the same way. In terms of the people that we work with and the family thing, it's again that sort of craft thing when people work at home or people work in a small community, they're all kind of together, they have their lunch together, things like that. So our thing also has been to trying to create employment for people who don't easily get employment in the space, and then upskilling them and training them upwards to be able to do the tasks that they do here. So people come from all sorts of backgrounds, from children of very disadvantaged people who migrated to the city and found themselves at a loss of what they can do in doing random things to stay employed. And also we work very closely with Karma, which is an organization for kids who effectively don't have parents. There could be different reasons why they don't have it. And again, because of stigma of coming from an NGO and being brought up in a thing, they find it difficult to get jobs that allow them the respect that they need to kind of, you know, force them into the real world. And those are two things that we kind of try and do, is make sure that everybody gets treated equally, no matter where you come from. And that as much as that work that we can do is done manually and not by machines, so it generates a larger number of employment.
I mean, that could be a testament for that. The handmade muffins and cookies are just a different category altogether as compared to any obstacle
as
well.
Thank you.
So yeah, going back to what you were talking about, conscious consumerism.
Yeah.
If you could tell me, what does it mean to you when you hear the word conscious consumerism?
I think fashion is the second most polluting industry in the world. So it's very important for us to buy or indulge. For me, I don't know about others, but you know, invest in pieces. We just don't buy for the sake of buying, or I don't follow seasons or trends. Things which I can wear over a period of time, things I can restyle and still make them look new. Because we really need to be conscious of what they're doing to our surroundings. So that's very, very important. That's why when I start to travel, I travel mostly 7 to 8 months a year. So I try to make my traveling the choice that I make on my traveling, sustainable, zero waste. And that's why I believe in pieces which I can wear for over a period of time. And they have to reflect my personality.
Pradeep, if you could tell us more, because you face this challenge a lot where you said that people come and say, show us something new. What do you look for in a consumer, or what who is a conscious consumer in your eyes? Because you're definitely catering to that person. We could come back to you, don't worry. Do you want to shed some light on it?
I think just somebody who's thoughtful about what they are buying and valuing it for what it is really, rather than just the price tag that it carries. And thinking about it as something that will be with them for a longer time, rather than just spontaneously buying it at the spur of moment and then forgetting about it in the 2 days. Like wear it 3 times and throw it away. And not just clothes, probably everything, technology or gadgets. Conscious consumer is somebody who will be conscious about any kind of buying or possessing. So it is more about a lifestyle rather than just fashion. And definitely fashion and technology, I think, are the two most indulging segment, indulging and polluting things for industries, for consumers.
So going into more about this stage in our country, what do you think is the need of the hour for the handicraft industry for growth or opportunities? What would you recommend or require help from outside? You guys are doing what you do best, but what would help you in your growth? If you can start, sorry.
See, I think people need to be more open about, you know, something which is, for our products especially, I would say that people need to be more open about, you know, challenges, or more acceptable about something which can be made a part of, you know, your life. And as I told, challenges that we have faced, and we still face a lot these days. You know, the like for our products, we have tried making it as raw as possible. So that is the whole point about, you know, the exposed concrete thing. Still, people want to go for, you know, something which is more finished, more polished, and they don't realize that, you know, there is a lot of hard work that we have put in. There's a lot of thought process that we have put in, that why we have left it like that. So yeah, people should be more open about accepting new things, accepting changes.
So more awareness to the consumer.
Exactly.
What about Indigene? What do you guys feel like?
I think awareness definitely is very, very important, because, you know, like a lot of people would question that, why is your product a certain price point, it needs so much maintenance, and then they're also charging so much more, of course, as compared to all the sales and all the deals that you get at the fast fashion stores. But I think, like what you said, that a conscious consumer knows what they're buying. I think they know what the story is. And it's not, I don't think brands like ours are out there to, you know, sabotage the entire buying community. Even if there is a small niche that we can cater to and they're happy with what they buy, and you know, it's always good to hear when somebody says, oh, I've worn that song, I just love it. It's kind of, it serves the purpose. And so it's okay if we don't have 1 million buyers. 100 will do, but if they're loyal and they like what they
do. In terms of support from like government or something, what do you think could be improved to help you run your businesses better?
I think everybody just needs more funds.
All the time. The change has to be at different levels. Of course, the consumer level, at the consumer level, where we all have to be more aware and conscious, like maybe fund investment in the product. But there's also a huge disparity. So there are even weavers or printers. There are purely kind of effort, and I mean, they're all established, but then there's the real karigar, you know, who's kind of sweating day and night to produce something for this big businessman or middleman. So whether the last person in the chain is really getting the worth of his time and energy and money is one of the major areas that needs to be looked at. And I think, of course, we keep hearing about a lot of government funding and government support that's happening into handlooms especially. I think they need to also give some attention to other crafts like you know, embroidery segment or other kind of art, whether it be it wood or sculpture or anything. It has to be more extensive rather than just handloom. And how much is really happening, one doesn't really get to know. I mean, okay, there might be a lot of funds, but what is really coming out of it? That's a true kind of.
Yeah, it's the first time that handloom is being taxed.
I think it's also like, I think it's no one particular thing like just funding or just taxation, but I think it's the general sort of policy approach to saying that we want to incentivize things made by hand and disincentivize things that are machine produced when both exist in the same marketplace. So that people are more encouraged. The gap, I mean, people go to Delhi Haat and then talk to a craftsman and say, itna mehenga kyun hai, ye toh 100 rupay ka iska Sarojini Nagar mein milta hai. And people have to understand that it's not made the same way, and it takes more effort, and it, you know, gets somebody a livelihood much more than the other product does. That only the shopkeepers making money in Sarojini Nagar. And so that approach to policy, looking at the entire thing holistically, saying that we've got to, wherever, like for example, garments or crafts, products that have traditionally existed have to be incentivized so that whether it's taxation or funding or whatever, becomes more feasible for people to sell them at the price that people want to buy. And the other things need to become slightly more expensive so that people don't buy the wasteful products that easily.
So encouragement from that level will become massive.
Awareness as well. Because sometimes you go, like you said, Delhi Haat, people are bargaining, where she's not up with these.
The knowledge is definitely limited.
Yeah. And when you go to like H&M, they would just see the tag and just go and whatever the amount is paid.
You never bargain at the store.
Yeah, never bargain. Yeah. So, and then it's fine for you to spend like 4,000 rupees, and then if the guy is charging you 600 rupees for something, and then you think it's not enough. So that's another thing.
So what are your individual dreams and visions for your businesses, for the handmade industry? What would you like to achieve? Maybe we can start with you, Jitin.
Yeah, I think for me, my dream is to kind of, even that we produce, so we want to, you know, sell a lot of it, but the idea is to then, the products that we work on are very manual and require, our cookies, for example, cannot be mechanized. I've met a lot of people who said, I need scale, karo, volume change, or we will produce. And I'm like, yeah, I want to produce, but I'd rather see setting up a unit near a village. There are 200 women who come into the kitchen and produce the quantities that we need, instead of trying to put like a 1 crore ka plant jahan pe na biscuit nikle ja rahe. So that's sort of the dream, to be able to create an ecosystem where we're able to give that much employment to people who do work with hand, instead of mechanizing the solutions that we need to scale our business.
Go on. Share your business plan.
Business plan, basically, it's not that much of a, you know, we don't require really, we do require craftsmen. The team that we have, they're amazing. You just have to tell them on the phone and they can get it done. Any, you know, they are that true.
now you can buy Gomark online.
We are present online also, but that was initial stages when we wanted to make, you know, when we wanted to make our presence felt in the market. You know, the existence that, okay, there is something which is made up of concrete. So initially we had started that. Now that is like that has taken a back, you know, like a, okay, it's like hua to hua, it's okay. But now we are directly contacting architects, interior designers. We are getting a lot of work from them. We are getting a lot of orders from them, which is really doing well. Because, you know, I think these industries where they purchase in bulk, especially architects, interior designers, they're the first people who can introduce such kind of products in the market to people, who can change the mindset. Obviously, if you want to beautify a home, you will definitely look for an interior designer. He can tell you what will go well with what.
So like taking up projects is easier to have that kind of
impact.
Your marketing, your product.
Exactly. And concrete is such a product that, you know, it can be molded in any form.
Anybody else wants to comment on
Well, I think, of course, who doesn't want good business? That being assigned to running a business. But I think we would really like people to know more about the story behind the engineering product. So, you know, I mean, how it's made, who are the makers, and
like 5 to 10 years from today, you still wouldn't change your format of how you work with women artists.
No, I mean, well, that's really the gist of the engineering.
I think right now for us it's to collectively grow. When we are at that stage where we can grow further, we still at a smaller scale. So definitely to have enough market so we can kind of expand our network of women and artisans who work with us.
Definitely for the next five years.
So speaking of markets, we're doing Handmade Collective on 9th and 10th of December, which is a Creators Bazaar. It's at this location only, in Saidullah Jam, New Delhi. If you guys could share what you're planning individually and collectively for the event, what is Gomark going to be offering? What can consumers come and browse through?
We can see that, you know, what all is possible in concrete. And they can touch, they will get an opportunity to see, you know, how does it feel, how does it look, how beautiful it looks.
So it's home products.
They are more into decor.
We'll be bringing forth our 4-meter Felentine collection. And part of it is unique because we've done a lot of recycle and reuse. So it's also a lot of fashion and stories like that.
Lots of exciting new food, hopefully a lot of India inspired flavors served in a cafe version so that it's easier for you to eat as you walk around. And there will be no thali to sit down and eat, but there will be a lot of food with Indian flavors and a lot of Ayurveda inspired hot chocolates that's going to be new on the menu. So,
works for the season.
Yeah, that's the idea.
I know that this event is open for families, kids. We're doing some activities.
Pets.
And you want to share what you're doing for the Handmade Collective?
You know, I'm really excited because I wore a lot of MDG this time in Paris and I loved it. But the cape was fantastic. When I walked in the streets of Paris, it was really like, it was literally flying, you know. I really felt like, yeah, you know. So that I'm really happy that people can come and meet them and see what they do. As well as Pyorgi, Aditi is not there. But I really love what she does and that she really embodies the spirit of nomadism, which was we always traveling. So I want to do an Insta meet to meet some of the people who follow me to talk about how to travel. You know, I have been traveling with my pets Marco Polo and Tigers for the last 1 year. And so we want to talk about traveling, we want to talk about sustainable ways of traveling because we travel with trains and we try to be zero waste. We don't use plastics, things like that. So that's another thing we want to talk with young people. And the third thing is that it's going to be a great platform to merge two things I really love, which is traveling and some of the handmade beautiful things. So it will be be a really nice interactive session for anyone who comes here.
So you're hosting an Insta meet on
Sunday,
which
on
is
Sunday 10 p.m. Around afternoon. Yeah, around that's the one.
You guys get in touch with Divya.
Yes.
Handle is dduggar on Instagram.
No, dduggardd.
Dduggardd, sorry.
Yeah.
You can just search Divya Dduggar.
Yeah, and I'm going to bring my dog Tigress as well. Right. So, because everyone wanted to meet her.
Jagmati is pet friendly.
Yeah, yeah, totally.
And she's really nice. She's really nice. So, she's not like going crazy. Marco Polo is a bit crazy. But Tigress is good. So, I want to come and talk about it because I want to tell people to go out and not to think so much. And basically make choices in life which are more research, meet people, travel, do things.
Yeah.
Get out basically.
And for kids who are coming, I think there's a portal. Are there any, you guys can share some light on the activities that are happening at the event.
We're gonna have Smita from Muddy Waters. She's bringing some stuff, and she's gonna get a portal wheel. I think it'll be open for people to try out their hands on it.
We have some surprise.
Add-ons
as
well.
So
people should
come here and see
what.
Right.
And I think it's fun to do, you know, you don't have such opportunity where you can meet like-minded people, be in a nice place like this where there is a really nice outside merged the decor.
And great food.
And
food
and popsicles.
Yeah.
So every time I see Jagmat Khela, I have to eat
their
popsicles.
The Parisian Gully of Delhi, definitely.
Parisian Gully, that's what you should hashtag.
Paris, if you cannot go to Paris, at least yahan to aa sakte hain.
No, I think it's important to shed light that how Handmade Collective was formed. It's not some organization, it's just a bunch of you guys, creative entrepreneurs, got together and thought that there should be an opportunity for business owners to do some kind of a shop slash activities for customers to interact and see the product. So all the challenges that we discussed that we face, we're trying to tackle that with this event, which is on 9th and 10th of December. And we're glad that we're doing it at Jagmat because it's in alignment with our thought process. Just closing words from all of you.
And I think we should mention all the brands which are going to be there because some of the people are not there. So
for
people
sure,
have,
yeah.
Like, you know.
Yeah, you guys can share the what all is going to be on offer. And
Of course, the brands that you see here are going to be there. Apart from that, we have Pure Ghee Designs. We have Flying Fish with jewelry. We have Benazir. More jewelry.
She's coming from Bangalore.
She's coming from Bangalore.
Nothing, no spends.
Yeah. And of course, Muddy Waters with ceramics. And we
Kinnell.
Have Kinnell with more clothing. So we explore more clothing, sarees, jewelry, ceramic,
bags, food,
yeah.
Drinks, yeah.
Homeware, tableware. You have the.
Yeah, so basically, you get ready for the season.
It's
that's
a perfect
it.
Way to spend your weekends.
Closing words
for
you guys.
Looking forward to the 9th and 10th.
Exactly. Emphasizing 9th and 10th.
And we want more people to come.
Yeah. No, you guys, it's very easy to find Jagmat Khela. Just put it on your Google map.
Yes.
We have valet parking.
Valet parking.
Yeah, that's very important.
So I think that's good then. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Thank you
for the chai. Oh my god, that was long.
Yeah.